the Olympic and its impact, the stadiums, how the city started recognizing and acknowledging the transport, and the same thing we are going through now. But most interesting of all, during that era, the 30s, when the expos started happening, there was a talk about the Art Deco movement, the Art Nouveau movement, and these events actually have documented these as architectural movements, which I'm trying to lead to what such events would lead into, what we're going to end up with here in Qatar after such an important event, which is the 2022. And we've seen how we're gearing up, whether it's transportation, better environment, not only that is driving us to reach our 2030 vision, but it's given us a power, a stronger power to proceed faster with this event. So we come to the stadiums, and it's amazing is that we are redefining stadiums. Stadiums historically being a concrete structure that hosts people sitting and watching the football. And then until China started doing the bird nest, and some few pieces of architecture started coming up in stadium. But the way of the vision of preserving our identity here in a totally new definition of identity is to where each stadium will have to have a story that belongs to our culture, whether it's the sea, whether it's the gahfiyya, the hat that we're wearing, or the literal way of translating it into the Beit al-Sha'ar, which is the tent. This is not a clear picture. Is that? No. These were the plans of a stadium. I'm talking about legacy. Cities as big as South Africa, which hosted the event, even in Brazil, they got so stuck with these stadiums, it was cheaper to demolish them than to maintain them. Now, these are cities with populations of millions. We're talking about, at that time, 2022, we are going to be around 3 ± million population. So what are you going to do with these massive projects? And it's interesting, as I had the pleasure of designing one of these stadiums, it was part of the brief and the competition is the legacy. What are you going to do, in our case, 40,000 seater? And they divided these locations to where the city will benefit. Similar things that what the legacy is going to keep for the neighborhood. And we were mentioning a certain distance for each area to have a sport place. You can have a magnificent sport place. And just to give you an example of one of the stadiums where we will dismantle 20,000 seats, we'll end up with 20,000 seats because it's 40,000 seats, and where that location is, they're going to be health spas, medical treatment, hosting the actual clubs of these neighborhoods. The surrounding of the stadium will turn into parks, so all the residents of that area are going to be able to actually come and use these parks. And the other stadium cases, they are turning some of these spaces into boutique hotels. They will be very rare to have. You're sitting in your suite or in your room and watching the football game. And this is part of the legacy. And interestingly, redefining the sort of identity, at least my school or where I came from, was taking the literal translation of our architecture into identity. But the beauty of working or having an influx of world-known architects from all over the world is that they look at your culture in a different perspective and sort of redefine it. And then you started realizing, wow, there is our definition of culture or identity goes beyond the aesthetics of the architecture. We're in the right place to give examples. But the color of our sea is an identity. The shapes of our dhows is an identity. The desert rose, I was so sort of mad in a happy way with John Nobel. How we look at this desert stone in the desert, but we never saw it as part of our culture, and it is part of our culture. The patterns and how it's translated. And then the different type of architecture that the client has challenged the best architects of the world to sort of, you can build in our nation, but it has to have a relation to our culture in a way or another. And we've seen beautiful examples started evolving, taking the pattern into a more contemporary way, taking the symbols of our Siddharta tree in a magnificent way. And to get somebody like I.M. Pei within the pyramid in the Louvre to attempt and do Islamic approach to the architecture was a phenomenal. And the guy was retired and he got so excited. And we ended up with this masterpiece influenced by something that definitely relates to the culture and at the same time sort of redefining the identity in a more modern way. And again, I like to end it up in this place, in this context, because going to the heart of Doha, which is, I grew up in these cities once upon a time, and to redefine it in a manner that takes it into contemporary level. And I think the birth here, like the Art Deco and the Art Nouveau was thriving in that era, I think the birth of a contemporary Qatari architecture is being born. It's like a cultural revolution, and I always say it's like a renaissance that we are going through now into the culture, because the comeback for our culture is not only reflected in architecture. I think this was started with His Highness the Emir Qadr back in the days to sort of have a cultural revolution, not only in architecture, but in our poetry, in our costumes, in our music, and that has revived it. And I think the definition of what we're going to inherit and with this architectural boom, and fortunately, all of these are by law has to be sustainable, whether it's LEED or GSAS or whatever it is. It's not a luxury anymore. The mosque here across the street that we got is maybe the only gold, platinum LEED certified mosque maybe in the world, which has won it. And this is definitely being defined by law in all government projects and on all the same. That's it, thank you.